So I'm here with Cindy, my next guest, and I've invited Cindy up here because she works in the field of addiction, but and also works with interventions. She also has experience with her own family with interventions. So I thought that it would be interesting to have her point of view and perspective, and we can open it up for some questions as well. So thanks for coming, Cindy.
Yes, you're welcome.
What I want to focus on is not the actual intervention itself. We see there's shows on television. We all know what intervention is. But we see that they're pretty useful and they work, but there's a lot of people that are still in need of interventions. And I think that there is a lot of family members who are afraid to take that first step or to cross that line to do an intervention. The more people have the understanding on how to find an interventionist or even do an intervention on their own, they will take the fear out of it so they actually go and they make that step. Because we know that treatment works and we've seen how interventions can work. It's just getting the person to the point where they're willing to do an intervention. So could you elaborate on that at all?
My parents, when I got sober 13 years ago, did an intervention on me. I am so grateful that they did that, because if they wouldn't have done that, I wouldn't be sober today. And they walked through the courage, they walked through the fear, and were able to actually get to the solution of doing the intervention.
Okay.
And also, you know, with my own family members and doing an intervention on one of my loved ones, I just knew, you know, the stuff that comes up, you know, the what ifs and, you know, what if this goes wrong and what if this goes wrong, you know, all those things that you think about when you're putting something like this together is pretty scary. What I had to do is just focus on the solution and getting my loved one into treatment.
Okay.
And knowing that was what he needed.
So if you can remember back 13 years ago when your family did an intervention on you, you said that it was good for you. That's what got you into treatment. And at the time, were you resistant to going, or was it almost like, oh, there you guys are,
oh,
I'm waiting for you?
I didn't have a problem. They had the problem. They were crazy, and I was in complete denial. I did not want to admit anything. I didn't want anybody to know.
13 years later, and now you're helping other people.
Yes.
You set up interventions for people.
And
you set up low-cost interventions.
And I love it. I do a lot of low cost. I help a lot of families, because right now, and especially in these times, you know, people don't have a lot of money for treatment. I love being able to help people.
What are the responses from most of the people when you say that they need to do an intervention? Do you feel like
there's no way they're going to go? My loved one, that's exactly just about what every one of them says. That's the reason why we do intervention. You know, and I walk them through the whole intervention process. We get them together in a loving way, just break through that denial. And so no wonder why they don't want to go. So we need to break that during the intervention.
You said that you had experience with your own family member. How long was that person using, and that you knew about it before you actually did the intervention?
Honestly, it was about 4 days when I knew for sure 100% that he was using.
Okay, we'll back up a little bit. Was there a little denial on that part too?
There was some denial, yes.
Okay.
And when it's in your own backyard, when you have a family member that has the disease, it's just a totally different situation. Your professional mind just goes out the door. And so I asked my loved one a few times if he wanted to go get help, and he told me that he wanted to do it on his own, that he could do it on his own, and he would. And we had a contract and everything, and, you know, I bought into it because I wanted to believe him. And that's, you know, what we do as nourishing people. We want to believe in our loved ones.
Yes. Looking back, or in your professional opinion as well, and I think I know the answer to this, whenever a parent suspects that there's using or drinking, the answer is usually yes.
Yeah.
You don't usually find out, oh, it's something different. They were depressed. It really
but you
was
just have hopes that it's not,
yeah.
You know?
That's what's difficult. So the hope keeps you in denial.
It was almost like I was addicted to my loved one's problem or him.
Oh, that's interesting.
And it's just like with the disease of drugs and alcohol, I wanted to take care of him and stay in that disease.
So you did the intervention after 4 days. And how did you feel after? Did you feel after you created a boundary, or what were your thoughts at that point?
Relief. Once it happens and it's done, and the, you know, when my loved one was driving down the street, I was just like, oh my God, he's leaving. And this is like your drug leaving you.
Mm-hmm.
And once he was there a few days afterwards, I felt relief right away.
I think there's a lot of people who are under the impression, which it could be, that the person needs to be ready. And I agree with that. But I also think that there's a line where, okay, the person doesn't know who they are or what they're doing. And if you are a loving family member, could you step in?
I hear that. You know, we got to wait till our loved one hits rock bottom. And I ask him, how can you wait? How are you going to be able to do that?
So it's good to hear from your question, actually. We have a lot of people in recovery, but it sounds like you have a loved one who's, or you want to make the decision to do an intervention.
I do. I do have a loved one. And I guess I felt that it's been time for a long time, but the same thing was happening where she thought she could do it herself. She didn't need to go to a recovery center, a rehab. And I wanted to believe her. I still want to believe her, but I know better. I believe I know better. Health-wise, I know it's, well, killing her. And it's destructive for the family. And she's so young and she's so beautiful. And she can do so much. And I hear the stories of people where it drags on with them for 10, 15, 20 years. And I don't want to see her in 20 years in the same situation. And I she's a strong girl, but I don't think that she's strong enough to do this alone.
What is the drug of choice?
Meth.
Okay, that's a tough one.
She leaves home and we don't know what she's doing. Mm. She could be doing every day or every other day, I don't know, we just don't know.
So she lives with you but leaves home to use, is that what happens?
She was living at home and then she just really permanently left. She has recently come back a couple of times. I know she wants to straighten her life out. She has made the call once to me, Mom, I want to come home. And then she left again. I mean, she got back into it and then she called her dad not too long ago, just a few days ago, and said she wanted to come home. So I believe she's at the point where she's ready. She wants to, but I still don't think she can do it alone.
Who is this loved one?
It's my daughter.
What's your daughter's name?
Her name's Megan.
Okay. And how old is she?
20.
She's 20?
Yeah. Yeah. This has been ongoing for 5, maybe 6 years. Not all with meth, but long enough with meth. And it breaks my heart.
What would you say to her right now?
I love her. And I want the world for her. And just please. Please do what we need to do to help you.
Well, you're so brave to come up here.
Yeah, I'm a brave girl.
Thanks for coming up here. What were you thinking out there in the audience?
That I knew that this was coming.
Well, you know you're struggling. Well, we know you're struggling. Mm-hmm. And I know you've tried. You've been through that cycle.
Yes, I have.
You know, so you understood that story.
Yes.
You know, it's like, why waste the time at this point? Mm-hmm. And I think you can feel the people in this room, the love in this room. There's many different things of sobriety, some other people that are looking to get sober as well. But it's the beauty of this group because we're all here and no one's judging you in any way. And we're all like, oh boy, we've been there before.
It's a relief, definitely, to know that everybody else has been through the same thing, because it's hard to explain to somebody that hasn't been there. It's hard to get them to understand, because that's what you're afraid of, is being judged by them. And nice to know that there's other people that feel exactly what you're going through. I've mostly just kind of just disappear. I'm the master of MIA, so but I finally decided that it's that I need my family there, and to not be afraid. They know that I'm in my addiction, so it's better to have them there rather than pushing them away. And now I've realized that I do need them and I need help, because I've been trying this on my own for years. as young as I am, it's been an ongoing battle, and I'm ready to stop it. I'm done with it.
What do you say? What do you think?
I'll take it.
Right on. All right.
I'm going to give you a hug, man.
I stand up and hug you, but I can't.